things out of your list. You have to buy groceries for the month. So what all questions can you have? Can you like type your questions in the comments? What questions do you go through while, you know, buying, before going to a supermarket and before buying anything? What all questions do you go through in your mind? Can you like type them in the comments? For example, so one thing could be, you know, what all do I have to buy, right? Let's say I have to buy vegetables, I have to buy fruits, and probably soaps, shampoos, and all. This is what, right? Yeah, brand is something. What brand do I have to buy? What price do I need to buy it at? What quality? Yeah, exactly. Yeah, right. So yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Thanks, Ufan. So yeah, you also have to keep a budget in mind, right? So the questions, some of the major questions that you have, let's go through a flow that you have, right? So the first one is obviously, what do you have to buy? You're out of things. Now you have to make a list of things. What do you need to buy, right? So you'll make a list, let's say shampoos, soaps, vegetables, fruits, right? Then the second question that comes to your mind is, now, where should I buy it from? Should I buy it from a big bazaar? Should I buy it from, let's say, Easy Day, or, you know, from a local Kirana shop? So this is the second question that happens in your mind. Third could be, okay, now I've decided a place to buy it from. So what brand do I need to buy it? What brand do I need to buy for it? Like shampoo could be, you know, Head and Shoulders or something like Dove. So it depends on needs. It depends on your price and budget. Right. So this is another question that you have in the flow. And another question that you can have, depending on your budget, is the price. What price are you willing to pay for the thing that you're buying? If you're going to a luxury upmarket shop, probably you're willing to spend more, right? If you're going to a local Kirana shop, probably you won't spend that much. Or if you're out of money at the end of the month or something like that, you're not willing to pay more, right? So price is another important factor that you have in mind. And lastly, when you're in the store, you know, you've bought all your things off your list, you're proceeding towards the checking counter, pricing counter, right? And on the way, you like think, do I need to buy anything else? Do I have any impulse purchases and all? Right. So this is another question you have for billing, right? So all these questions, these are the questions you face as a customer, you know, in the whole buying process. So in a way, the major question that you're trying to answer is, how can I get the most value for my money, right? That is a major question we as customers are trying to answer in our head, right? So we keep these questions in the mind because these are important, and these will be used later on, right? Okay. So I'll give a quick introduction to retail in India. And yeah, so this is important because, given how huge retail in India is right now, it's already in the top five retail markets by value, approximately $600 billion. And it's expected to touch $1 trillion by 2020. And it's the fastest growing market in the world. And of this, only 8% is organized retail market. What is organized retail market? Organized retail market means, probably shops and stores that are registered, that are paying taxes and all, that are recognized by the government. Those are called organized retail stores and all, right? And these are only 8%. The rest of them are not organized. They're not paying taxes. They're not registered and all. So here's, you know, there's a huge opportunity over here right now. And also, you may have noticed in the last 4 or 5 years, there has been a huge, influx of e-commerce companies. And this is primarily driven by the increase in the number of internet users, especially recently using Jio. Jio was a main factor, it brought a lot of people online, and it is further fueling the e-commerce growth, right? So two factors that have been major instrumental to the growth of retail in India. One is policies, and second, technology, right? So policies may more or less depend on the government, how they're framing the policies, how, liberal the policies are, how open they are becoming. And obviously FDI norms are also changing. FDI norms was the reason, one of the major reasons that e-commerce was able to set up in India. You know, Flipkart getting funds from outside investors, Amazon entering India, other retail chains also, you know, trying to enter India using these norms. And technology, obviously, with internet and all. So these two main factors have huge potential to change the retail landscape in India. And it's already changing, right? But there's also some challenges right now, you know, very specific and unique to India. One is geographically dispersed population, you know, population spread, firstly, a huge population, and that to spread over a huge area in the country. Second is small ticket sizes, which is, you know, low value of orders. People aren't buying high value orders in India, probably because of the poverty and all. Third is complex distribution network. You know, there's a lot of still not connectivity to places in India. You don't have roads in, you know, far off places. So, you know, distribution channels and all, these are tough. And obviously, fourth is the little use of IT systems, you know, still growing, still developing. And some of the other factors are also, you know, limitations of mass media and existence of counterfeit goods. We've already seen that, you know, in a day-to-day life. Just a second. No comments. Okay. So, yeah. So, what to expect today? So, I'll briefly explain how I've, you know, structured this presentation. So, first, I'll be introducing myself in the next slide. You know, giving a bit of a background, you know, my own background, what I've studied, where I've worked. Then I'll move on to the detail basics, some concepts and definitions in detail that we use. After that, I'll be explaining why detail analytics is important to us. We as analysts, you know, why it is important to us. And then I'll be discussing some techniques used in detail analytics, some techniques that are specific to detail analytics only. Right, and one of these techniques I'll be taking you through a hands-on session also. I made a code on R, and I'll be explaining this technique on R. I hope everyone is comfortable with R. That this is something I'm assuming that you know, we have a basic understanding of R. Okay, and lastly, something important is career opportunities in retail analytics. You know, how and where, what companies are using retail analytics, and what all opportunities are there specifically in India, right? So this is how I structured the presentation today. Okay. So yeah, who am I? So basically, I'm an analytics professional. I've been working for 5 years now, and I have been working in the analytics industry only. So I have worked with companies like Jabong.com, Dunnhumby, and right now I'm in working with Royal Bank of Scotland. So the first 4 years of my career was spent more or less in the retail industry only. So Jabong, I spent 2 years. Jabong is an e-commerce company, if you're not aware, and basically online retail only. And Dunnhumby is a proper retail analytics company, and it's a UK headquartered company, and the clients it has immediately your retail giants and all like Carrefour, Tesco, and you know, clients like these. So a lot of retail analytics work happens in Dunnhumby. So that was a very valuable experience for me. And I've also studied you know, analytics from ISB. I've undergone an analytics program from ISB. I've also been certified in SAS. And one thing that I'm very passionate about and interested in is data visualization and storytelling, right? If you want, you can look me up in LinkedIn using this link. Okay. Any questions? Okay. Regression in R. No, I wouldn't say regression in R is related to market basket. Market basket is something different. So we'll come to this, and you'll realize how different regression in R is as compared to regression. How market basket is different comparison to regression, right? Market basket is a association algorithm. Regression is something else, right? I'll explain market basket, and you'll get to know how different it is from regression, right? Okay. So, retail basics. So there are some terms you should be familiar with, you know, when working with any client, you know, so firstly, obviously, what is a retailer? The most simplest definition that I could find on the net is something, a retailer is someone who purchases goods from manufacturers at a cost and sells them to consumers at a higher price. And in this process makes a profit, and this profit keeps them, you know, helps them survive in the business world, right? So this also can be twisted a bit, you know, this retailer can be also a manufacturer and a retailer at the same time. Like you have Apple, the company. Does someone have a question? Okay. Is someone trying to ask a question? Okay, I don't think so. Yeah. So can you please go on mute? That's a request. Thank you. So a retailer can also be a manufacturer. In the case, like example, the company Apple, they also make the phones and they also sell them at their own stores, right? So this is one deviation from this definition, but more or less, retailer is generally someone selling others' goods at a higher price, right? Then there is something called channels and formats. So what is channels and formats? Channels are, you know, how you're selling your goods, which is one model that is very famous is offline and the online model. So in offline model, you have retailers like Big Bazaar, you know, they're selling their goods majorly offline only in brick and mortar stores, you know, in physical stores, and Big Bazaar, Easy Day, something like More, or your local Kirana shops. These are all offline channels. And online is something, you know, online e-commerce companies, majorly e-commerce companies. So you have Amazon, Flipkart, Jabong, Myntra, stuff like this, right? In this also, you can have mix and match. Like some offline retailers, you know, given the competition you have with online retailers, some offline retailers are trying to set up their own online e-commerce portals also. Like you have Big Bazaar trying to do that. And, you know, other also, like Tesco, you have, they have their own online page also where you can order stuff. Walmart, everything, every one of them have their, at this stage, all the big ones, they have their own e-commerce also set up. So they're not purely offline. They also have an e-commerce setup. Similarly for online also, initially they started as online retailers like Amazon. They started as online. But even now you can see, if you've heard the news, Amazon is trying to open their own stores, physical stores. You know, they're not purely online anymore now. Everyone is trying to, you know, expand the reach into both the formats. Because I don't think like anyone can purely offline and purely online in this, you know, competitive age. So this is one format that is very important. Okay. So the types of stores that you have, the major ones that you all are familiar with, One of them is the convenience store, you know, local grocery shop. So the characteristics of this convenience store is, you know, they have limited stock, limited categories. The prices are higher probably, you know, as compared to other bigger stores. And it is easy to, you know, just enter the shop and get your items. So, you know, in a way, they're speedy to shop at. Like there's not a lot of hassle or a lot of time that is taken to shop. Something bigger than this is the department store, right? A department store could be something like More, Altair Builders More. So they have a larger stock as compared to the convenience store. They have more categories, right? The prices are lower than what you find in a convenience store, because, you know, they're able to buy in bulk and, you know, in a way reduce prices. But they're also bigger in size, hence, you know, it is slightly, you know, you take a lot of time at these stores. if you increase the size of the store even more, you have something called hypermarkets or supermarkets, right? The characteristics of them are like they have a huge almost all the categories that you can possibly know of. They have a very large stock, right? They have very low prices also. They're able to, you know, reduce the prices. And obviously, since they're so big in size, and so you majorly go for a monthly stock up kind of thing at these stores. And hence, it takes a lot of time to shop at these stores, right? So a hypermarket or a supermarket could be something like a big bazaar store near your home. They're usually very big in size, right? And another type of store is an e-tailer, or basically an online e-commerce company, that is called an e-tailer, right? So Amazon is an e-tailer, Flipkart is an e-tailer, right? Okay, so these are the four major ones, more popular ones. Others that we see every day around us are something like hawkers. Hawkers are one person selling stuff on the street. That is also retailer only. So hawkers, they're not registered. Like they're counted in as unorganized retail only. Your pop-up shops, you know, something at a fair or you see a stall or something like that, that is called a pop-up shop. Discount stores is another concept that is not very popular in India, I think. I haven't seen many discount stores over here. But these stores are made specifically for discount only. You get a lot of discount over here, but you have to buy in bulk. So that is the concept of a discount store. Okay, so hypermarket is a very huge store, right? So generally, big bazaars over here, they're not qualified to be called hypermarket. They're generally supermarket only. Hypermarket has a very huge size. I don't think there's enough space in India for retail stores to be qualified as a hypermarket. Some of them could be, like the definition is not very clear. But generally, big bazaars over here are counted as supermarkets only. Right. Okay. I'll move on. We have some more definitions. So we can also classify the retail stores on the basis of the goods sold. Right. Some of them sell only food items, you know, perishable and non-perishable. Perishable is something that that doesn't last for too long, like probably milk or bread. These are perishable items, right? And non-perishable items in food could be something like chips, you know, which take a lot of time to perish. They have a long expiry date. Chips or toffees, you know, you get the point, right? So these are perishable and non-perishable items, food items. And in non-food, you have FMCG, fast-moving consumer goods, consumer durables, or the hardline and specialist goods, right? Consumer durables or FMCG is something like, you know, soaps, shampoos, brushes, notebooks, I don't know, something like this, right? Hardline retailers are retailers selling automobiles, appliances, electronics, or furniture, you know, stuff like that. And specialist retailers are, you know, they like cater to a very niche audience, like organic markets, green grocers, or probably you can also say art galleries, bookstores, handicrafts, musical instruments. So they sell a very special kind of a category only, right? So this is also how you can classify the stores. Or a store can also be mix and match of both non-food and food, right? Okay, the next thing that we have, which is something important to a retail store, are the key retail functions. So more or less, there are six major functions that you have in any retail store, right? And it is kind of a flow only. So you start with demand forecasting, right? So you have to forecast, start with the demand, you know, you have to calculate on how many items you have to purchase or the, like how many items will be sold in the next month. You have to build some models based on the previous sales or on, you know, predicting based on the data. you have to forecast a demand for the next month, right? So let's say this month you sold 90 items. This month you sold 90 items. You're expecting some growth for the next month. So next month, say you sell 100 items, right? So in a way, you are trying to forecast the demand for next month. On the basis of the demand, you'll place an order to the suppliers, right? You tell Pepsi that, okay, I need 100 bottles for the next month, right? So this process is called procurement. You know, placing the order to the supplier, and you know, asking them for the goods. So now, when Pepsi will send you 100 bottles, right? Need some way to get the bottles. So the way of getting the bottles is the logistics part of it. You know, Pepsi will send you the bottles using a truck or some auto or something like that, some means of transportation. That is your logistics part. And warehousing part is the part where, you know, when the goods have arrived at your warehouse, you have to store these bottles. So you have to have a warehouse for that, or some kind of a godown or something, some place to store your goods. So that part is the warehousing part, right? And category management also, you have to, you know, keep a track of what all categories do you want to keep. Because as a retailer, you only have some limited space, right? You don't have infinite space, right? You can only stock a certain particular kind of categories, particular kind of set of items only in your store. And this decision that you have to take on what categories to stock, on what items stock, that is an important one that you have to manage. So based on the margin that you get from items, based on the size of the items, right? You have to trade off between these factors. So this is called category management. One more thing that is very key, very important to retail processes, the pricing of the goods. Now you can price it as low as you want, or you can price it as high as you want. But if you price it very high, you know, price sensitive people won't buy from you. If the place that you live in, the people can't afford very high prices, no one will buy from your store, right? And if it is too low, right, people might think that, you know, you're selling poor quality stuff, and they might not come to your store also. In that case, you know, especially the upmarket people, you know, they judge a item by its price. A lot of people judge an item by its price. So, you know, if you're selling a shoe for, let's say, normally it is sold for 3,000. If you're selling a Nike shoe for 1,000 rupees, someone will doubt you. You know, is it a fake item? Why is it selling for so low, right? So you have to maintain a pricing trade-off. Also, if you sell for too low, you won't have any margins. That is also there. That is a major factor. So in a way, you have to maintain do calculations on pricing. You have to set an optimal price for your goods so that you can have the audience and also your margins together. You know, you have to balance both of these, right? And lastly, promotions. Promotions is how you, you know, within store, how you promote your product, and outside the store, how you promote your store. You have to pull people into your store first, and when the people are there in your store, you have to promote the items within the store so that people buy higher margin items, people buy more items, so that you make more profit, right? So this is what promotions means. I'll just quickly check for the questions. Okay, no questions. Fine. Okay, one more thought exercise now, next one. Now you have to think as a retailer, right? Don't look at the questions. Now, if you're a retailer, assume that you're a retailer. Okay, let's say you're Big Bazaar. Now you have to tell me in the comments, what all questions can you have? As a retailer, what questions do you start with? I've told you the processes over here, these six functions, right? Key retail functions. Now you have to tell me what all questions as a retailer you can have. Then type your questions in the comment box. Thank you. What should we keep exactly? Basically, the categories, and within the categories, what items, and within what items, what brands, which brands are giving me the highest profit, highest margin, what will products to sell, how much space needed. Yeah, space is important. Profit margins, profitability. Yeah, exactly. What do people want to buy? How much, at what price? Yeah, location. Yeah, competitor, exactly. We also need to keep in mind our competitors, you know, what they are selling. Probably we can sell something extra in which pulls in the customer. That is also important in keeping an eye on the competition. Okay. Yeah, so these are majorly the questions that a retailer faces, right? So exactly, so what categories to stock, right? Should I keep only chips, or chips and cold drink? Should I keep soaps? Should I keep shampoos? Should I keep shower gels? You know, these are all categories. And within categories also, you have subcategories. Like there are 4 or 5 levels of category generally you have in a retail store. And you have to, you know, on this, what you can afford, what space you have, on the type of customers you have nearby, on the basis of the competition, on the basis of the competition that you have nearby, you have to, you know, decide on the categories that you have to stock, right? Secondly, how can you convince people to buy from you? Like, why should I go to a Big Bazaar store when I can buy from Amazon? Like, what value does Big Bazaar provide to me that I should go to a Big Bazaar store and not buy from Amazon? I can, you know, buy from Amazon. It is convenient for me. So Big Bazaar, probably the advantage that it has, it could be on the price. It couldn't be the customer service. You know, you have a person greeting you, a person helping you. You can see and feel the product in a Big Bazaar. You can do that in Amazon, right? So that is some convincing that you have to do. You have to basically market your store and your products. So another question could be which brands to stock. Probably, you know, some brand is giving me a better margin as compared to some other brand. But the other brand, which isn't giving me a better margin, could be a more popular one, right? Generally, you see, you know, the more popular a brand is, the bigger a brand is, they, you know, kind of have a power with them. You know, they can demand lower margins because, you know, as Jabong, if I'm Jabong, right? If I don't stock Nike products, Nike is very popular, right? And if I don't stock Nike products because they're not giving me a higher margin, so then people won't come to my site because a lot of people are looking for Nike products, right? So I have to keep Nike also. I have to keep my margins also. That is one trade-off that you have to decide on, right? Sometimes you have to go for a lower margin just to keep a famous brand also. That happens a lot. I have to bleed in one brand so that I have to recover my margins from another brand. A lot of companies have to do this. Another question could be, how do I price my products optimally? We've already discussed a bit of pricing earlier, right? And how do I sell one extra product to the customer? So let's say the list that I went to the store with had 20 items, right? I had to buy 20 items for the month. Now, I generally buy 20 items only from Big Bazaar, right? Now, the store wants to earn more profit from me. It wants to extract as much money as it can from me. So the question they have is, how can I convince Ayush to buy 21 products today instead of 20? What can I do? How can I convince him to buy one more product from me so that I get that extra margin from him this month, right? So there are a lot of techniques that employ, you know, giving discounts, bundling with other items, giving bundle discounts, or, you know, they could place, there's one technique that these retailers use, which is placing your impulse purchases near the billing counters. You must have seen small shelves and all near your billing counters, right? They have candies, batteries, razors and all. So these are all impulse purchases. These are items for impulse purchases. So, you know, this is one technique, you know, you're standing in the line, you're bored, and you see a nice chocolate, pick up the chocolate unknowingly. And that is one technique to convince you, you know, one extra product for the month, right? So basically what the retailer is thinking is, how can I get most value from my customers and the suppliers, right? So this is a major question that they're trying to ask. Okay, moving on. Just one second. Yeah, this is important demographic where I'm selling to. Men, women, yeah, exactly. This is basically something called segmentation. You have to understand the audience that you have around you, right? If you're living in Ghaziabad, in Delhi, you have to understand what kind of customers that they're there around you, right? So are they upmarket customers? Like, are they very rich? Are they poor? Are they middle class? This is something that you have to keep in mind. And are there a lot of women living around? Are they working class? Are they businessmen, right? So this is something, you have to create segments. You have to create and understand segments of your customers. And that is how you decide on what to stock and how to promote. This is all, you know, related. Okay. Yeah. The third exercise that you have, okay, this is not really an exercise, but the third point that you have, you're an analyst, right? You're training to be analysts. So as a retail analyst, it is important for us to keep the customer, the retailer, and the supplier in mind, right? We have to think from the perspective of all three of them. And this is how, you know, we have to come up with relevant insights. We have to make decisions, help them make decisions so that all three are, you know, balanced. We have to strike a balance between customers, retailers, and suppliers, right? So the questions that I made you think about earlier, you know, when I made you think as a customer and then when I made you think as a retailer, all these questions you have to keep in mind, you know, when you're designing solutions for your customers, basically for retailers or your customers. So these are questions very important to your stakeholders, right? Okay. So now that you know about retail, so why do retail analytics? So retail analytics is basically, you know, you're using data, retail data, transaction data, to provide insights to your stakeholders. Your stakeholders could be retailers, your stakeholders could be customers, and you're helping them take decisions on key retail functions. You know, the functions that we've discussed before, the 6 months: demand forecasting, procurement, logistics, category management, pricing, and promotions. So as a retail analyst, you're asking questions in these key retail functions, and you're answering these questions using data, right? You're designing data solutions for your stakeholders. Okay. So, and one important question is, why even do analytics in retail? Like, what's the use? You know, you've seen stores, you've seen big bazaars, they're all profitable, they're selling the stuff, Amazon is doing the stuff. But why do retail analytics? So if you have been reading the news, so in offline retail, you know, these big bazaars, more and easy day and all, they're suffering a lot because of the, you know, advent of e-commerce companies. People are not buying, people are not going to these stores, they're not buying from these stores. They prefer shopping online only these days. Like, personally for me, like, I hardly go to a retail store right now. I used to go to my local kirana shops, to my local grocers, you know, even sometimes big bazaars and all. But I stopped that. Everything is available online only. So, you know, your offline retailers are bleeding. They're bleeding money. They're losing customers. So that is why retail analytics is important, you know, to help them reattract the customers, to help them maintain the customers, to, you know, extract as much profit as they can from the existing customers, to, you know, optimize the marketing. So these are some of the functions. And if you think about the online commerce, e-commerce, even there, your analytics and retail is very important, because right now, none of the e-commerce companies, none of them are profitable, right? Even Amazon in India is not profitable. Flipkart is huge into losses. Jabong, Myntra, everyone is taking losses, right? And they need retail analytics to, you know, figure out a way to make profit, figure out a way to, you know, extract customers from offline retail. They need a way to market their products, to market their services, and, you know, understand the customers, do pricing management, do promotions. So in both offline and online retail, your analytics and retail is very important so that each other can survive in this, you know, very competitive market. And they have to identify opportunity also to grow. That is why. Okay. And what kind of data is there in retail analytics? So generally, let me just look for questions first. Okay, you were asking customer segmentation. Yeah, so demographics and all were customer segmentation only. This is something dividing base, the customers on the basis of demographics, like gender, region, prices, money, sorry, salaries and all. This is all customer segmentation only. There are different kinds of customer segmentation. Right. Okay. I was telling you about the kind of data that is there in retail analytics. So you must have noticed that, you know, when you're doing a billing, doing billing of your items in a store, you get a receipt of items, right? If you remember what is there in the receipt, so you have a date, you know, when the transaction took place, like let's say 10th December 2017. And time also, what time you that receipt was generated, right? You have the item name or the item and the item number, something like that, and the price and the total, right? So these are some of the famous, some of the major data points that you have in your receipts that is given to you, right? Behind the scenes in the servers of the company where they're storing the data, they're generating even more data over there. They're storing what kind of a customer are you, what who are you basically, you know, if you're using a loyalty card or, you know, some kind of a card, retail card. So they're identifying you by their by your own card, right? So they're able to identify, okay, Ayush is going to the store, he's purchasing these items, so these categories he's buying into. Okay, what else? This is the time he prefers. Right. So you have transaction data, you have customer data, you have inventory data, and also you have marketing data. If you're going to marketing, how you're marketing. You have, if you have an e-commerce portal, an online portal, you have a lot more data than these ones. So you have your visitor data, how they're clicking on the website flow, the customer flow, what they're putting in the carts. So this is the kind of data that is there. But majorly, generally in retail analytics, transaction, a lot can be done just with transaction data only, right? If you have the items that you bought, the prices that you bought at, bought them at, the date time, only these data points are enough to design a lot of solutions, right? And in my previous company in Rahambi, we were only using customer data and transaction data to design almost all the solutions that we had. So, right. So it, even these small limited number of data points are enough to generate a lot of data solutions, you know, optimize the store to a very large extent. Okay. Okay, no more questions. Okay. So I'll be discussing some of the techniques that we use. So yeah, so generally in retail analytics companies, the solutions that I've observed that they have, one of them is pricing and promotions, right? So in pricing, you know, a retailer comes to me and says, tell me how to price this product. So these are the kind of customers they have. They'll provide me with the customer data, right? And they'll tell me, tell me how to price this product. Tell me how to price these categories or something like that, right? So we have to look at, have a look at the customers. So what kind of customers I may be having, right? And if you can do external research, probably what kind of prices the customer, the competitors are having, right? So let's say I'm Walmart, right? And I'm coming to Dhanambi to say, boss, you have to do pricing optimization for me, right? And they'll give me the data of the customers and they'll say, you can use this data and come up with a strategy to price the products based on the categories, or based come up with a strategy to price the categories, right? So I have to look at a lot of variables and, you know, design some algorithms so that I can optimize the pricing of the products. So I have to keep the margins in mind. I have to keep the customers in mind, you know, what kind of customers I have. And I have to deliver the optimum prices to the retailer so that, you know, they're able to make profit. Another thing is promotions. In promotions, I have to come up with a way to, you know, promote the products within a store. So let's say, you know, you're wanting to sell some particular brand more within a store. Like, let's say, so Pepsi gives you better discount. Pepsi gives you better margin. So you're trying to promote Pepsi in your store, right? You stock both Coke and Pepsi and Thumbs Up in your store. But since Pepsi is giving you better margin, so you're trying to promote Pepsi in your store, right? But not everyone drinks Pepsi, right? So you have to design your promotions in a way, you know, so that you're able to attract Coke or Thumbs Up customers to switch to Pepsi. So you can probably give a discount over there, right? You have to identify the customers which are already drink Pepsi, which can switch, and you know, you have to basically optimize the process. You have to identify the relevant customers. You have to segment them into different buckets and try to identify which customers are willing to switch, which customers are not willing to switch. Because the customers that are not willing to switch, you don't want to waste money and time on them, right? So the customers which can be swayed to buy a higher margin product, you have to focus on them. Okay. Category optimization. So in category optimization, we have solutions designed to, you know, optimize what all categories to place in the store, what all categories to focus on, right? So so there are a lot of categories, a lot of retail, a lot of suppliers that you have, but the store space that you have is limited, right? You have to decide, you have to give preferences to categories based on what kind of customers you're having, what kind of region you're setting up your store in, right? So let's say in India, saris and all, sari is something that sells a lot. People wear saris over here, you're right. But you can't set up a category of sari in a country like US or Brazil, something like that, right? They don't wear saris over there. So this category you can't introduce in Brazil. You can only have sari category in India, right? And even in food, there are certain kinds of food that Indians have. There are certain kind of foods that people from Britain have, from UK have. That food is completely different. So the categories that you have over here, you have to optimize them for the region, for the people you have, right? And within category also, you have to optimize the products because the shelf space is limited. You can only display a certain amount of products over there, right? So that is why category optimization is very important. Okay, one another solution that I have personally worked on was something called new product development. So this solution was basically, let's say you're Pepsi, okay, and you want to come up with a new flavor of Pepsi in the market, right? Let's say apple flavored Pepsi. So now you don't know how you know, customers will react to this apple flavored Pepsi, right? So you can't suddenly introduce these to every store in the country. You have to test the product in certain specific stores, and you have to test, you have to measure how this product is performing in the market, right? So you'll introduce this product very slowly in limited stores, in limited regions, for limited type of customers, and you'll measure the performance of this product. You know, how many sales this product is taking up, what kind of customers are buying this product, how it is growing month on month. So this product that I built, I worked upon, we used to, you know, whenever a new product was launched, we used to track the performance of the product for 6 months, right? And we used to put out a report for every 1, 2, 3, and 6 months on the performance of this product, right? How your performance, what is the performance in the first month? What is the performance in the second month? What all people are buying? What kind of people are buying? How much it is selling? What region it is selling better at, and what region it is not selling in, right? So these are some of the things that you measure when you're launching a new product. And on the basis of these, on the basis of the performance measures, we used to recommend them, you know, this product is a star performer. This product isn't selling well. You can probably delist this. Or probably we used to say that, you know, this is a very niche product. It is selling to some very specific kind of people. So you can probably market them this product, right? So this kind of recommendation, something that retailers are looking for, you know, some kind of guidance on how the product is performing, new product is performing. So this was one solution that a lot of article companies did develop. And next we have is custom segmentations. I'll just quickly check for questions. Sorry. Yeah. Another solution that a lot of analytical companies build are customer segmentations, right? So specifically for my company, for Dunnabi, we used to have a lot of different kinds of customer segmentations. So a segmentation can be on the basis of price. It can be on the basis of your age, your demographics, right? The categories that you're buying into. All these factors were used to create different kind of segmentations, right? For example, prices, right? So majorly in retail, we have three kinds of segmentation for customers. One is the upmarket customer. Upmarket customer is someone who spends a lot of money on buying expensive stuff, you know, who doesn't mind spending money on items, who splurges, who has a lot of money, who buys expensive stuff, you know. So this kind of customer we can use to target expensive items or higher priced brands. The second one is the middle market customer, right? They're slightly price sensitive, but they're still willing to spend more money as compared to the last category. And the last category is the price sensitive ones, right? These price sensitive segmentation, you know, they're very touchy on the price. So they're not loyal to a brand. They'll go for the brand that is offering them lower prices, right? Probably the upmarket ones are more loyal to a brand, even despite the prices. But these price sensitive customers, they're not loyal to a brand majorly. They're more into, you know, how I can get the lowest price on a product. You know, whenever price increases, they switch their preferences to a lower price one, right? So this is one example of a segmentation that we have. And okay, another segmentation that I remember was on the basis of what the people are buying, like what kind of things the people come to buy at the store, you know. So for example, let's say I'm a working class person, right? So majorly buy monthly groceries and you know, something to eat, sandwiches and all if available. Let's say there's a mom who has two kids, you know, she's more into buying, you know, stuff for making lunch for her kids, you know, buying into kids categories, right? Another could be something, an old person. An old person is more into buying medicines, more into buying, you know, other types of categories related to senior citizens. So on the basis of what we are buying, we can segment customers in this way, right? And this kind of segmentation is used in the next kind of solution, which is called shopping missions. Shopping mission is something basically trying to understand why a customer is coming to the store, right? So using transaction data, I'm trying to identify why you're coming to the store. So let's, for example, let's say you have a party at home, right? So the kind of items that you buy for a party at home are completely different from the kind of items you buy, let's say, for baking a cake, right? So if you have a party at home, you're probably buying soft drinks, you're buying chips, you're buying snacks, right? And if you have to bake a cake, you're buying probably eggs, you're buying flour, you're buying baking items, utensils, right? So these are the missions. So one could be a baking mission, one could be a party mission, one could be a monthly top up. You're buying a lot of items in your basket, and you know, buying in bulk, the value of the order is very high. So that can be classified as a monthly top up mission. Or you're going to store to buy, you know, quickly grab something to eat. So that could be termed as a lunch mission, right? So these are missions, you know, why you're going to store. That is what a mission is. And another last technique that I remember that we used was something called store layout. So this was a solution that we built for the retailers. And using this technique, using this technique called store layout, we were able to recommend to those retailers how they should place the categories in the store. Like if you go into a store, you know, things are arranged in a very specific way, right? And this technique, store layout, is used to optimize the layout of a store. So in a way, if I'm using this technique will recommend me what all categories to place together so that the sales can go up, right? So let's say using this technique, I'm able to identify that, you know, if people buy milk, they're also buying eggs, right? So using this technique, I can identify, you know, milk and eggs are being bought together. So we can place them together so that people, if they're buying eggs, they also remember to buy milk, because they're placed together and they'll remember buying them together, right? Or this algorithm will recommend what all categories are closely related, how they're associated, and it will recommend me accordingly, like what to place together, what to place apart from each other, right? And the next step that we have, we'll be studying in our today's hands-on, we're studying the algorithm that we have, which is basically used in the store layout technique, right? So the store layout technique uses an algorithm called market basket. It uses something called market basket analysis. And basically it is an application of market basket analysis only, right? And in the next step, we'll be going for hands-on on the market basket analysis, right? I'll just quickly check for questions. No questions. Okay. Just give me a minute. I'll just drink some water. If you have any questions, you can type in the questions. Yeah, okay. So our hands-on today is the market basket analysis. This is a very famous technique that is used in retail analytics. And this has a lot of applications, not just in retail analytics. It has a lot of applications outside of retail analytics also, right? So market basket analysis, or MBA, is kind of an affinity analysis or associative analysis. And this technique is used to discover co-occurrence relationships among activities, right? So as an example, like you must have gone to Amazon or Flipkart, and you must have seen, you know, below your products, you must have seen something like, you know, people who viewed this also viewed X, right? People who bought also bought Y. Customers who bought X also bought Y. So this is generated by the market basket analysis. You're right. So we are trying to determine how items and purchases are related to each other, right? So the applications of this market basket analysis are cross-selling, store layout, and shopping missions, which is discussed in the previous slide, right? And one more example of this could be, you know, so let's say we have discovered using this technique that people are buying shampoos and conditioners together, right? But like whenever people are buying shampoos, they're also buying conditioner. So as a retailer, if I have to put, if I put both of the items on promotion at the same time, like it isn't very useful for me because people are already buying both of them together. So it makes sense for me to put only one item at a promotion, because if I put both items at the promotion, I'm losing money, right? I already know that if I put a discount shampoo, so if people are buying shampoos, they already buy a conditioner. So I don't need to put any discount on conditioner, right? So this is how market basket can help us. So basically one product is driving the sales of another product. Okay. Yeah. So it's time to open the code. Go to R. Let's check for questions. Okay. Okay, so two questions. So major tools that are used in retail analytics. So are you asking about the like analytical tools that we have? Like we are using R, we're using SAS, we're using Python for, you know, transforming the data. We're using databases like SQL, SQL databases majorly to store the data and extract data. And there are also a lot of visualization tools like Tableau or, you know, inbuilt tools like R only, which can, you know, help us visualize data. So that is there. A lot of processing can also happen in Excel. So the common analytical tools that you have are also used in data analytics, right? And second question is, what is the difference between market basket analysis and predictive analysis? Okay, so market basket in a way is trying to, it's not predicting anything, right? It's just telling you an association between things. Like, this association is already existing in the data, right? You're not trying to predict anything extra out of this. You're not predicting anything. Whereas in predictive analysis, you're trying to determine future value, right? Like this is what my understanding is. In market basket, you're not predicting anything. That relationship that is coming out of the data as a result is already existing in reality, right? Let's say you're saying that, you know, if you're buying shampoo, you're also buying conditioner. So I know that is happening. Like, I don't have to predict anything. That is already happening. In predictive analysis, yeah, exactly. So demand forecasting, where you have quantitative data, you know, they have to predict the number of orders. That is something where predictive analytics will be used, right? So this is not a quantitative data. You're not predicting anything away. So that is the difference, you know, what I'm able to explain. So I hope it is clear to you. Another question is, are the market basket analysis stuff can be done in R? Yeah. So yeah, it can be done completely in R. Like R has a lot of algorithms, a lot of techniques can be applied in R. You have a lot of packages, also made specially for retail analytics only. So yeah, it can be done in R completely. You know, you just have to store data somewhere, probably in the form of CSVs in your databases. You can pull that into R, you can transform your data into R in R, you can apply the algorithms that are already there in R using the packages. And you can also visualize the data if you want. You know, R has very good visualization capabilities, and you can use that to visualize your data. Yeah, I can share the code and it is. I can share that, yeah. Another question is from Ashwarya is, okay, so yeah, so R and SAS can be used for Predictive also. They can be used not just for Predictive, in fact, they're like any kind of analysis you can perform in R and SAS. They're not limited to just Predictive analysis. You can also do machine learning in that, AI stuff in that. Python and R are like, okay, you're asking if Python is right for AI. Okay, you can also do AI stuff. The algorithm that you have in Python, your machine learning and AI algorithms that you have, they're also there in Python also and R also, right? But Python is something that is gaining popularity these days. So it is not that you stuff that you can do in Python, you can't do in R. The algorithms are there in both of them, right? But Python is something that is becoming more popular these days, and it is better suited in terms of that. That is just there, right? And all the retail analytics can be done in R and SAS and Python itself. It's basically all about your algorithms only, right? And all the algorithms are majorly there in almost all the languages these days. So that is not a problem. So yeah, exactly. So we'll be using the ALOS package only. So we'll be coming to that. Exactly, ALOS is used for MBA. Okay, so moving on to the code. So, okay. So what we'll start by loading the data, right? Our data is generally in a transaction format, right? Generally, data that we get from companies, or if you're storing data, you're storing it in a you have a transaction number, you have the item number, item name or the number, right? And you can have multiple rows for the data, right? Transaction number one, item number one, transaction number two, item number two, something like that. Or you can also have data in a format where only one row corresponds to one order, right? So for the code we are going to run today, there is you can load the data, but your data has to be in a transaction class format, right? A transaction class format is a format in basically transaction format in which the transaction are stored, and it is specific, it is needed, it is required for the A rules library, for the A priority algorithm, right? So this is very specific to this algorithm. So we need to convert our data into this transaction class format. We need to remember this. And if you want to know more about how to convert your data into this format, you can use this link that I've provided over here. Or you can just search for, transaction class format. And there are a lot of tutorials that can help you convert the data into this format. And if you already have data in that format, that is very, helpful. And you can readily start performing analysis on that, right? To perform our market basket analysis, we need to install a package called ARules. ARules is the name of the package that we need to install, right? As correctly identified over here. So this line is basically checking if ARules is installed. If not, it is installing package and loading that package, right? So I've already run this line, but you can run this line on your own if you have the code, right? It's very simple, nothing much. Okay, right. So I was talking about transaction class format data set, right? So there's an inbuilt data set in R called groceries. Groceries is the name of the inbuilt data set that we have. And this data set has the transactions, a lot of transactions in it. So what I'll do is I'll run this part of code, right? And I'm using this command, I loaded the data. So groceries data set is now loaded. Just remember that groceries is within ARules only, right? it is not loaded by default. You have to install this library and load this library first, right? Only then you can load the groceries data set. So I've loaded this data set. Now it generally what you, if you type head, you can see in the first 5 rows of data, but since this data is in a transactional format, you cannot use this head command to view the rows. For this, we need to use inspect command, inspect function, right? So if I run this, now you can see the rows in the data set, right? So this is the format of the data set that I'm talking about, right? So each row corresponds to one order or one basket or one transaction, right? So once you went to the store, you bought these items. Second time you went to the store, you bought these items. Third time you bought just this, right? So this is the way that the data is structured. And there are a lot of rows in a data set, right? So this is the data set that we use, to get the association, right? Okay. And now this is the algorithm, a priori algorithm is the one that is used in the market basket analysis, right? And we run this algorithm on a data set, groceries, and we provide parameters to limit the, some parameters which I'll explain, to limit the data that we have, right? And we store the results in a variable called rules. So I'll explain what these are, all these is. So you run a priori, you provide some parameters, and you store the data, store results and rules, right? So I'll just run this quickly. Okay, so this has run over here. You can see the log over here. I'll explain it shortly. Okay. And what I'll do is I'll inspect the rules variable that we just created. So options, this function is limiting the decimal points to two, right? And inspect is used to basically see the what kind of data rules are created. Okay, so now rule, what I'm talking about, the word rule, this is the rule, right? So let's say if I'm purchasing butter and jam, so what is the likelihood that I'll purchase whole milk? So this thing, this complete thing is a rule, right? If I'm purchasing X, then what is the relationship of purchasing Y or whole milk? So this thing, this relationship is called a rule, right? And this rules is storing all these relationships. It is creating permutations, combinations of all the items, all the transactions, and creating rules of all the items that we have in data set, right? Okay, and you must have noticed that there is something called LHS and something called RHS. So LHS if I'm purchasing X, that is called LHS. If I've already purchased this, and RHS is something what I'm about to purchase, like what the association of this, right? So if I'm purchasing LHS, what is the association or the affinity of me purchasing Y? So these are what LHS and RHS are. We get some more parameters called variables called support, confidence, and lift. And these are very important in understanding the results of our algorithm, right? So I have a very good link with me, and this link will help us understand support, confidence, and lift in a better way. So I'll go to this link. I'll say comments. Empty cars is also an inbuilt data set only, and groceries is also an inbuilt data set. Similar, they both are similar, just that groceries is in the A-Rules package. And is confidence our percentage? Yeah, so I'll just explain what confidence is. So I have this link. You can use this link. You can search for e-priority algorithm on KD Nugget's website, right? And you'll get this link. So this is the simplest definition of, you know, support lift and support confidence and lift that I've come across. So I'll be using this link to explain to you what the definition is, right? So way of the first one is support. So support is, let's say these are transactions that you have, right? Transaction one is apple, beer, rice, meat. Transaction two is apple, beer, and rice only. So likewise, you have 8 transactions, right? So support is, support of an item is the frequency or the percentage, the time of the times that item is occurring in the data set, right? So basically it is how popular that item set is as measured by the proportion of transactions. Basically the proportion of the item, right? So in this one, apple is occurring 4 times, 4 upon the number of total transactions, which is 8, right? So the support for apple is 4/8 or 0.5, right? Similarly, we can also have support for combinations of items. So let's say the support for apple and beer together. What is the support for apple and beer together? So apple, beer over here, 1, 2, 3, just 3, right? So apple and beer, this we'll write 3 over here upon 8, right? So because these are occurring 3 times together, apple and beer, so 3 upon 8, it will be the support for apple and beer, right? Similarly, we can have something for, you know, apple, beer, and rice. Apple, beer, and rice is over here and over here. So the support of this apple, beer, and rice will be 2/8 or 25%, right? So basically, it is the proportion of transactions in which an item set appears, right? And this is exactly what is shown over here. So this figure means that this thing is occurring, this whole thing is occurring in this proportion together, right? So this is the this is the support which we're defining. Yeah. Okay. I hope this is clear. So the second measure that we have, which is the confidence, right? So confidence is the thing. You can see values like 0.9, 0.91, right? So confidence is how likely item Y is purchased when item X is purchased. So if I'm purchasing, so if I have to calculate the confidence for when I'm purchasing an apple, how likely is beer being purchased, right? So apple and likelihood for beer. So the formula is support for apple and beer upon support for apple. So support for apple and beer over here is apple, beer, okay, three is the number of times it is happening, and support is 3/8 for apple and beer. For apple only, it is 4/8, right? So the confidence will be support of this and support of this upon support of this, which comes out to be 3/4 or 75%. Is this clear? So support for both of these upon support for this, right? And support we have defined above, which is basically the proportion of transactions. So one thing about confidence is that, you know, it is inflating. Let's say apple is popular and beer is also popular. Like they're both having a high support, or like they generally purchase when someone comes to a store, right? If you're going to Big Bazaar and you're purchasing apples and beer all the time, like it is popular. So the confidence value will be inflated in a way, right? Because you're not accounting for the popularity of the item over here. So this is one drawback. So it might misrepresent the importance of an association, right? So it is accounting only for how popular the apples are, but not the beers, right? So this is one drawback of this measure, right? So what this is saying is, if beer is also very popular in general, there will be a higher chance that transaction containing apples will also contain beers, thus inflating the confidence measure, right? Yeah, I agree with the statement. Yeah, it depends on data, kind of data you have, and what for what you're calculating confidence for, right? It depends on the items, it depends on data, exactly, right? So this is the confidence measure. Third measure that we have is called lift, and it is similar to confidence, but we add something extra over here, which is to check the inflation due to the popularity. So the drawback that we have over here is getting solved over here by adding this support for beer over here, right? So this will ensure that, you know, the data is not inflated. It is accounting for the popularity of both the items, right? So support for apple and beer upon support for apple into support for beer is what lift is, right? And lift is basically used to tell how dependent or independent the item set is, right? If the lift is greater than one, it means you know, these are dependent, right? So one is depending on other. Like if apple is if lift is greater than one for apple and beer, so every time apple is purchased, there's a strong likelihood that beer will also be purchased. If the lift is one, exactly one, it means that both of them are independent. Like purchasing apple doesn't affect purchasing a beer. And if the lift is less than zero, less than one, it means they are like if apple is purchased, then there is in a way unlikely that beer will be purchased. So that is how lift is you know, measured. So for example, this chart you see. So for canned beer and soda, this rule, the support is 1%. So let's ignore the support for one, like for this thing. Let's focus on the confidence lift, right? So the confidence is 20%. Like it means that, you know, both of them are very popular, but the lift is very low. So you see, this is a case of where both canned beer and soda are being purchased together and both are very popular, right? So that is why the confidence is being getting inflated over here. It like both are independent of each other because the lift is one, but since both are popular, the confidence is getting inflated. So this is not really very useful to us, you know, in terms of data, in terms of insights. This is not any insight to us because both are very popular. In the next case, the confidence is low, but the lift is less than one, right? And lift less than one means that they're not associated. So if canned beer is purchased, there is low chance that berries will also be purchased because the lift is less than one. And for this case, the confidence is 1%, but the lift is greater than one, right? So this means that confidence is low. It is not inflated also, but also the lift is greater than one, right? So this is a true insight that we get from this data that, you know, when people are purchasing beer, they're also purchasing cosmetics. So that is something that is a useful insight that we can gain from data. So this is something that is relevant data point for us, right? So this is how you actually view the data that we have over here. Similarly, how, you know, you can interpret this whole rule using this way that I've explained. And you also need to keep a check on the count that we have over here. You know, if the count is too low, the data might become unreliable. You know, just one or two transactions is not enough to, you know, be very reliable. So you can limit the number of counts. You can set a certain threshold for the counts right? Okay. So I'll just summarize this result again. In the rules data set, in the rules variable that we had, so the length of the rule is important. You know, length means how many items they are considering in the rule. Like, so this is a two. The length of this rule is two, right? Because we are having two items in this. In earlier case, over here the length of the rule is three, because we are having three items, right? So this is what the this rule length is. Three for rule length three, we have 29 items. Rule length four, we have 29 items. For five, we have 140 items. And for six, we have 12, right? This is root sizes of the rule, right? And this is this distribution of the rules. So yeah, from 3 to 6. And for support, the minimum value is from 0.001 to 102, going up to 0.00315. You must have noticed that we have, you know, provided a parameter over here, and this is setting a minimum threshold for support and minimum threshold for confidence. So that is why the, you know, confidence over here is minimum is 0.8 and going up to 1, right? That is the reason. We can also not give the parameters, that is up to you, but giving such a threshold ensures that, you know, you have quality in your data. Yeah. Lift is going from 3.1 up to 11.2, right? Okay, I'll move on quickly. Yeah, there's nothing. I've explained this. Yeah, so this is something, this part you can use to sort the data set by confidence, and similarly sort the data set rules by lift, right? So there's nothing much in this. You can see it is sorted by confidence. So highest confidence is coming up first, and rest of them will come below. Similarly for rules, for lift. So the highest lift, 11.2, is coming over here, then decreasing lift is coming. Okay. No. So yeah, we don't have to use only the lift. We also need to keep an eye on the confidence, right? Remember this? So lift plus confidence, right? So lift confidence gives us a measure of how, like, is the data getting inflated, like due to popularity, and lift is a measure of, you know, check of the popularity. So use both of them, see that confidence is not too much inflated, and lift is also significant. Like, so this is the kind of a true insight that we are getting. So the confidence is low, but the lift is higher, right? So both of these together are telling us that this is a insight, like this is something that we didn't know, right? If the confidence high, it is telling us, yeah, both are popular, so obviously they must be getting purchased only. Like, if I'm going to a store and purchasing beer and soda, like if they are popular, I'll be purchasing them only, right? So it is likely to purchase. So it doesn't give me any additional insight that I already know, but this is an additional insight, and it is getting, they're getting this from looking at both the factors, not just lift, right? Okay. So you can just sort your rules. You can also limit the number of rules that you have. Like, you can say, I only want to see three item sets in my data, right? So now you have only three, maximum three. Maximum, you can use maximum three to limit to three. So liquor, okay. So like, you have only curd, cereals, and whole milk, butter, jam, and whole milk. So you can limit the number of item sets that you have in your rules, right? Similarly, you can also put a minimum threshold that you have called min length. So max length will tell the maximum length, and min length will tell the minimum length of a item set, right? So min length will give you more than three, more than two. We have four over here. This thing has four things over here, four item sets, right? Another thing that we can do with this rules is we can check individually, like it's there's something that we want to target. Like let's say I'm targeting butter. Like okay, I'll just run this once. So I just want to know if my RHS has butter. So what all LHS can be there? Like so what are the customers likely to purchase before buying butter, right? So if the people are purchasing butter, they must have purchased either whipped cream hard cheese or yogurt and rice or curd and chocolate, and like these are the support, confidence and lift for all these rules, right? So you can see that if your people are purchasing butter, they must have purchased this also before with this support, lift and confidence, right? We can also invert this question. We can also ask, what are customers likely to buy if they purchase butter? So if I first purchase butter, if I first put butter in my basket, right, over here, then what is the second thing? What is the more likely thing that people are likely to buy? So if I'm buying butter over here, so I'm more likely to buy confidence low over here, confidence 0.5 over here, but lift is higher than one. So I'm more likely to buy whole milk, most likely to buy whole milk, right? So this is how we are interpreting this rule, right? With 50% confidence and 1.9 lift, I'm more likely to buy whole milk than I've already bought butter, right? So yeah, so this is more or less the a priori algorithm that we use for market basket analysis. And this rules that have been generated, you know, you can further process them, and you can, if you play around with the data more, you can see what all categories are associated with each other. I don't have time for that, for visualizing the data right now. We're running out of time, I think. But we can visualize the data, and within R only, we can visualize how these categories are related, right? It will give you a diagram or network kind of a thing. It will show you how the items are related. And that is very useful when designing store layouts, right? It will give you a network diagram of the stores, store categories or the items, and you can use the network diagram to determine how to place items in your store. And you can also, play around, limit the support, confidence and lift over here in rules. And you can, discover insights on what are the, very hidden gems, hidden insights, what kind of products, have a very high lift, but, you're not able to identify with your gut feeling. So this is where this is very important, discovering hidden insights. So yeah, so this is the gist of market basket analysis. I hope everything is clear. Okay, there's one question. Yeah. So if you reduce the length, if you reduce the length, you can identify, you can build one-on-one relationships or two-to-one relationships. You identify these. So, you can get able to identify items better because, individually you're able to identify what items are dependent on what items, right? If you increase the length, then you can identify groups of items that are purchased together. So that is the difference what the length makes, right? I think the recording will be available. I think Shweta can help on that after this.
Yes, the recording and the codes will be shared with everyone.
Okay, great. I'll be also sharing the code to Shweta and, I think she can help with the code where the code will be loaded, right? Just one more thing that is left for today, which is career opportunities, right? So in India, there are a lot of companies which are into offline retail analytics and online retail analytics, right? So I have listed some of them over here. Like one of the famous ones is Manthan Retail, Capillary Tech that I've heard about. And some a lot of startups also there, Bridge2i is also there, Bridge2i. Right. These are some of the famous ones that I know about. Then so you can apply as these companies. They have positions for retail analytics. They have clients, you know, in India and outside India, majorly outside of India, for retail analytics. For example, Dambi, my company, my previous company, they had a lot of foreign clients. Like Tesco was the biggest client. In fact, Tesco owned Dambi. Tesco owns Dambi. So Tesco was obviously the biggest retailer that they had as a client. Then they also had clients in different other companies, different other countries, like, you know, North America, Brazil, South America, and China and Japan, something like this, right? So all the big retailers were their clients. And similar to Dambi, their companies, consulting companies like Accenture, like, you know, McKinsey, they also have a lot of retail clients. They have a lot of retail projects, you know, retail teams. And they also built a lot of similar solutions on based on retail analytics. So it's not very different when you go to company to company. The solutions are more or less the same. Just that the client differs, that, you know, the size of the data differs. That is what changes. And the kind of knowledge you can gain at these companies. So yeah, definitely with e-commerce coming, with the policy changes, there is a lot of scope for retail analytics, you know, especially if you specialize in this, there are a lot of companies doing this. So the opportunities are very high. I would be cautious of online retailers at this moment. If you're going with the big ones like Flipkart, Amazon and all, that is good because they still have the funds. They're still, you know, still surviving. But I would be cautious of the smaller e-commerce companies at this moment. You know, they're not doing very well. So if you're going for e-commerce companies, just be careful. Just, you know, have a check of their funds and all, how they're funding them, what profitability they have. But if you can go to a retail, if you can go to an analytics company which is into retail, that will be better, personally, I would say. Right. So, and, you know, if you open up LinkedIn or Naukri.com, there are a lot of opportunities you'll see. So, yeah. So that is there as far as retail analytics is concerned. I hope this was insightful to you. Yeah, you learn things, new things. And this is all I have to share today. Any more questions? Okay, visualization. So visualization diagram, you know what I can do? I can add that to the code and I can share that code with Shweta and that can be shared, right? I'll have to add that to the code. And yeah, definitely there is scope for freshers industry. Like I've already told you about some solutions, right? So if you can do some sample projects on these solutions, if you can learn some techniques, like if you can learn market basket analysis, if you can learn some techniques that are used, and you know, if you can show some sample projects related to analytics and then approach the companies, that will be a very useful thing when applying. But you have to study yourself first. That is required. I'll be sharing the code, don't worry. Any other questions? Sample project.
Yeah.
What you can do is you can.
Yeah, we have some we have some sample projects that we already do at Ivy. So, Pradeep, that will have to be done from our side. So that, you know, you can get in touch with us at the email ID I'll just provide you. So we will be able to help you with that.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. Any more questions?
Yes, thank you so much, Ayush. It's been a pleasure having you, and I'm sure with your insights and your experience, I'm sure all of us, in fact, even I've been pretty glued. So thank you so much for your time and your effort, and everyone for being, you know, so patient and being there for quite some time. So, and I'm sure all of you have learned so much. Thank you so much. We'll be sending across the code and the video to all of you, and it's going to be uploaded on YouTube. So just in case, you know, you miss out on my mail or something, you can go to our YouTube channel, subscribe to it, anytime you know we upload something, you'll get an intimation. So that is something that you should do. Yeah. All right. So thank you, Ayush.
Thank you. Thank you, Shweta. Thank you, everyone, for coming.
Thank you, everyone. Good night.
Good night.